Well, maybe now people will remember that it's not Jordan Peele directing Candyman, the new Candyman, but Nia DaCosta. Yes, it's been very frustrating to see people talk about that upcoming sequel and never discuss Nia DaCosta. They're always like, Jordan Peele's Candyman. But I think that's over. But who wouldn't remember DaCosta's name after that brilliant shadow puppet trailer she posted on June 17th for Candyman? That was such a strong, bold, artistic swing for a home run, and I think she hit a home run. And in fact, that makes me feel alone that she's a great choice for Captain Marvel 2. Side note though, speaking of Jordan Peele, since it seems that Kevin Feige's ear can be bent, Brie Larson got Destin Daniel Cretton his job on Shang-Chi. James Gunn talked up Peyton Reed. Why? Peyton Reed's not horrible. He could be better, though, although we'll talk about Marvel directors in just a moment. And Tessa Thompson has worked with Nia DaCosta and likely talked her up. So maybe Nia DaCosta could pay it forward to Jordan Peele, who, of course, hired her for Candyman, and slingshot him into Blade, because he's my top choice to direct that movie. He'd be absolutely perfect. Although, Marvel clearly doesn't spend a lot of money on directors, as Jordan Peele already priced himself out of the Marvel directing family. Because with the exception of Sam Raimi and Ryan Coogler, Sam Raimi was a bit of a bigger deal. You know, he'd of course done the Spider-Man movies, but I think his star had settled down to certainly around the same level of Creed, which was a very big deal for Ryan Coogler. You know, that was like a legit major movie. That Coogler had directed. But for the most part, Kevin Feige likes to go for new, up-and-coming, or undiscovered talent. In other words, cheap. That's a very nice way to say cheap. But I don't blame him. It's working out for Kevin Feige. And also, on the flip side, Kevin Feige has become a bit of a kingmaker when it comes to directors. And hopefully, he can be a queenmaker too. In fact, he's on a hiring streak when it comes to women. Kate Shortland, Chloe Zhao, and now Nia DaCosta. I hope it works out better for them than Anna Boden. I'll talk about her momentarily as well. Now, so far, no women have been able to come even close to Patty Jenkins when it comes to directing a big blockbuster movie. But there's always got to be at first, and I'm excited to see these women step up to the plate. We haven't seen anything about Eternals, but I think Black Widow looks at least solid so far. It has a Winter Soldier vibe to it, and I'm very happy for Kate Shortland for achieving that. Now, one reason that Marvel doesn't spend a lot of money on directors is that all their movies are pretty much the same. And Kevin Feige and his second unit directing team take point. Remember that other female director who was considered for Black Widow? She told on Kevin Feige and said, "Don't worry, we'll direct all the action scenes for you." And she was like, "But I'd like to direct them." She should have just waited until she was the director and then said, "I'd like to direct them," and made Kevin Feige fight her about it. But anyway, sometimes this cookie-cutter approach works. Most of the time it works, in fact. Sometimes it doesn't, like with the first Captain Marvel movie. That was devoid of any real direction whatsoever. And you know, when I saw their other film, Mississippi Something, I wasn't surprised, because that was a real clunker. But I have to tell you that Anna Boden and Ryan Fleck have gone on to direct several episodes of Mrs. America, which just came out, and they did a fantastic job there. So I don't know what happened. Maybe they learned on Captain Marvel. But Captain Marvel is one of the worst directed Marvel movies. I'm just saying what we all know is true. To date, only James Gunn, Taika Waititi, and Ryan Coogler have been able to inject some of their own personality into their Marvel movies. The others are all coming off a very successful assembly line. Scott Derrickson, to be fair, also had a lot of personality, but perhaps too much personality because he got himself fired. All right, so anyway, the positive of Marvel's strict creative control, you might be like, this sounds pretty awful, Grace. But the positive is that with so much strict control, you could also call that a safety net. And it allows directors with no experience on big movies to step up and direct a big movie. I mean, like, Kevin Feige's like Willy Wonka here, handing out golden tickets to the front of the director's line. You go from, you know, hardly having any experience, you can shoot to the top and become a named director. That's pretty good. I mean, I guess I would let him direct my action sequences if that's what he was offering. I'd be like, I'll direct the action sequences on my next movie, thank you very much. So I get frustrated. Sometimes some people can't see the forest for the trees when it comes to making deals. So that's an important life lesson. There's always another movie down the pipeline. Never live or die on one movie. A director directs many movies throughout their career. That's the goal. Now, speaking of directors and their careers, it usually takes one whole movie for a director to get the hang of things, VFX and scope-wise. So, that's always a little bit of a concern. Even with someone like the Russo brothers, they got exponentially better as their tenure at Marvel went on. And Captain Marvel 2 is the biggest of the big Marvel movies. As I've reported to you, and as many others have heard and reported, it will be a mini-Avengers movie, covering the Secret Invasion storyline, which means many, many guest stars. But two of those guest stars, perhaps even supporting characters, will surely be the Rambeau family. Is Maria still alive? Peggy Carter style? She'll be Captain Marvel is like so cap sometimes. And then also Ms. Marvel is said to appear in the movie. And of course she's modeled after the Captain Marvel character, so that makes a lot of sense. And both of course, you know, if it's just Monica Rambeau, but if it's Monica Rambeau and Ms. Marvel, those are both characters of color. Now Nia DaCosta's first feature film, which was also her breakout movie, Little Woods, explored the complicated relationship between two women and co-star Tessa Thompson. As I said, perhaps she vouched for DaCosta. And female relationships will, of course, be at the core of Captain Marvel 2, as they should be. If there ever will be an A-Force movie, Captain Marvel will be a big part of it. Brie Larson has been advocating for that film. So have other female talent at Marvel, but Brie Larson, she's the most advocate-y, as I believe she is in real life. So expect a couple A-Force-like moments in Captain Marvel 2. But because it will also be a full-blown Secret Invasion story, either introducing it or this, you know, I think it'll probably introduce it, and then we'll get like another Avengers movie like quickly after that will be maybe the full Secret Invasion story. We'll see what they do. Kevin Feige sometimes only loosely adapts. But there should still be plenty of male characters too. And that's important. It's important to have the feminism of Captain Marvel, but also male characters. Because one of the things that made the first Captain Marvel so successful was Nick Fury's large role, really co-star, and Ben Mendelsohn's Skrull leader, who of course will, I'm sure, be intimately involved here as well. Hopefully they both will be. I'm sure some people will complain about Captain Marvel 2 having an agenda and this just being further evidence of it. But when your star, we don't know too much about Nia DaCosta quite yet, but we certainly do about Brie Larson. But when your star, and even the character, it's like no one ever read a Captain Marvel comic. She's a huge feminist. Of course, the movie will reflect that, as it should, as it should. Although, this is at least one rare occasion where DC beat Marvel to the punch, because Wonder Woman 1984 will also be exploring a complicated female relationship. We love to see it! I love to see all these women in the space. And, you know, this is a friendly competition, and I'm very, very excited about it. So what do you think of Nia DaCosta as the director of Captain Marvel 2? Also, I want to say on a side note, it's a very big deal. Usually they match ethnicity, to the lead, to the story, ethnicity and gender. So I think it's really important to show that people can tell all different types of stories. And you know, I think I think Nia DaCosta, seems Kevin Feige met with a bunch of women. So as long as Nia DaCosta had to have a good pitch. But I think it's real progress for a black female director to be directing a movie with a white lead. I think that's really fantastic. So there's progress all over the place here. And you know, that's what you want to see going forward. You've seen that with some male black directors. For instance, Antoine Fuqua works a lot with Mark Wahlberg. But I think it's another step in that direction. It needs to become not a rarity, but the norm. So I think this is fantastic. What do you think? Share your thoughts down below. Subscribe today. And of course, as always, you can check out some more videos right now.